And welcome back to another week of The Take. I'm Bill Gannon.
I'm John Spinato.
And our special guest tonight,
Casp'a.
Casp'a's in the house.
Casp'a.
Yeah, we want to wish everybody a happy 2017.
Absolutely.
First show of the year.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we got a pretty good guest right out of the gates here.
Absolutely.
It's not
off
bad.
To a running start.
Yeah. So if we could just talk about you a little bit.
Sure.
Yeah. What's aspiring... Now, I know we talked beforehand. It's not rap and it's not hip hop.
It's not hip hop. It's urban pop.
Urban pop. Okay.
Urban pop.
Yeah.
There you go.
So that's what's coming out. So we got the urban pop coming out, and it's and you just were pretty excited because you just released an album. What is it, November?
Yeah. November. Yeah.
Okay. Then what's the name of the album?
Name of the album is called Unchain the Panther.
Unchain the Panther. We got the Panther on there too.
Yeah. Gotta show it. Bam.
That's right there.
Yeah. So, show it again. Show it again. They're just zooming in on it.
Yeah, zooming in on it right there.
There
you go. Got a good look.
So
a panther.
I follow you on Twitter, so I got a chance to see some of the clips of the songs and things like that.
Yeah.
So going out, it's pretty cool because every once in a while, like I said, I scroll down and all of a sudden I get to get entertained because I just hit that little, was it Thriller?
Because Triller.
Yeah, Triller.
Yeah, because I was looking at my Instagram and you came in the notifications. Yeah. I was like, oh, okay.
I want to say the last time he was on the show, it was a long time ago. We didn't have all the technology that we have now and everything.
Yeah.
But
we
actually had a lot of feedback from a lot of fans, a lot of people hitting up the we had a lot of people going back and watching it on the internet and stuff like that. I want to say right off the bat, I thought there was 126 the next day that you were there, and I think it ended up somewhere like around 167 or something like that, people that hit the internet after the show, you know, after you were on that show. So you probably have a big, pretty big following around, at least around Wallingford. So I don't know if you knew that, but people were interested in what you were doing and what you're, you know, so. But if we go to a clip now and then we can kind of explain it, we'll go see one of the songs and we'll take it from there.
Dancing and playing with the camera.
So that's you dancing and playing with the camera?
Yeah.
Ah, that's pretty cool. So that's a taste of, you know, one of the video clips that he sent to us tonight. So that's one I always watch on Twitter. So that's one But how do I, because I have the problem, and I'm terrible with all this electronic stuff and everything. Uh-huh. So for somebody that likes your songs or whatever, they can go, how do they get to see that?
Well, I'm glad you asked that.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you that right now. Pretty much, I'm everywhere now. Like, I'm on YouTube, I'm on iTunes, I'm on Apple Music, I'm on Spotify, Tidal, everything. You can even Google me. Google Casp'a, Casp'a. So, you pretty much go to that, and you can stream me, you can buy me. It's whatever.
It's all there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you have any tour dates coming up? I know you're probably working on that coming out of the new year. I know it's tough to right out of the gates, you know.
Well, actually, I'm moving.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Ah.
So I don't want it to be where it's like, okay, team, let's get together. And then we do like one amazing show. And then be like, well, it's been fun, but I got to go.
You got to take off. Yeah.
Yeah, I want to have a team that I could be like committed to.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like have a team where it's like we're there like forever.
All right.
Not where I just, like, say, well, it's been a good run. No, I don't want to do that. So.
It's better off having, you know, the people behind you and the followers and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So where are you moving to?
North Carolina.
North Carolina. Mm-hmm. Ah, that's a nice place down there.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not
really,
bad at all.
Really friendly folks.
And cheaper, too.
Yeah. Definitely. I got my eyes on some apartment. I couldn't believe, like, the prices.
Yeah.
And basically, like, I'm going to tell you right now, I got plans.
Yeah.
I got huge plans. I'm going to make sure they work.
Oh, that's excellent. So, we hope that, we get to say, hey, you started off, you know, did an interview for us, you know, before you get really big.
Oh,
so,
yeah
it's pretty cool.
Definitely.
Yeah. And don't forget us later on.
I won't.
So, that'd be cool. Yeah. So, but, now, the big plans coming up and everything. Do you have looking to get like a bigger label or something like that? Or?
I was actually thinking about that, and I think that'd be like a great idea.
Yeah.
One label actually had their eyes on me. That's here.
Yeah.
But also they were in North Carolina as well.
Oh, that's pretty good.
So I'm like, okay, maybe this will work out. So we'll see. If not, then I'm gonna venture off to like other places. I'm not gonna pigeonhole my options.
Right.
I'm gonna keep it moving.
Well, you see these guys, and I know there's a couple singers, and it's funny, they were talking, and a lot of times you have to have thick skin because somebody says, oh, your music's terrible or whatever. And it's like, and then also, you know, I can't think of the guy's name right now, and he was out there, and I know now he's selling albums left and right, and he's big. Yeah. He's, you know, he had a couple top tens and all that. But he actually got turned down by 17 people before – before they actually made it. And I know George Lucas went to, he went to a ton of people for Star Wars. Yeah. Everybody said, this is god awful. Nobody's going to buy this. This is terrible. So, and then all of a sudden, now it's the one of the biggest franchise ever. You know, so you're out there doing it. So, you definitely wish you luck and everything, but you got to, I like how your attitude towards it is, I'm not going to quit. You know, if I need to. Go an extra mile. You're going to go an extra mile, right?
Believe me, I've had some rough experiences where people would just be like, all right, that's it. Show's over. Because there was a time where I was performing, right?
Okay.
And it was with a band.
Yeah.
I didn't know the band from a hole in the wall. And what happened was I was like, okay, we can get up there. We could do the song. Will you guys be able to, like, match it up? Yeah, we could do that. They couldn't. I went up there, and I'm like, all right, that's it. Like, I jumped off stage. They're like, my manager's like, oh, no. You got to go back up there. And they're like, sing a cappella. And I'm like, all right. So I sang a cappella. I wouldn't really advise anyone to do that unless you absolutely know you won't be off.
Right.
Because me and my girl were actually talking about this. We were like, I wouldn't do that. Because it's very easy to go off key when you do a cappella. So you just want to have music behind you.
Right. That's a lot easier.
Yeah.
And it sounds better.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it is.
It
is tough. When we were talking to you beforehand, I said, you reminded me of Jason Derulo.
You're not the first to say that either.
Yeah, because when we were out there, and I was like, he's got some moves, dance moves, and he's got the singing towards it. So that's where I was like, that's the comparison. I love him. So I was like, I just give him like I said, that video that we saw, I see that all the time. Usually comes up on my Twitter feed because I get to follow you and all that stuff and see where you're going and all that. So it's pretty cool. You have a lot of fans out there. I notice, like, after you put something out, they'll actually give you feedback.
Yes.
Do you take that feedback? How do you do that? Like, say somebody loves a song. Now, do you try to kind of copy a song like that? Or do you say, you know what, they like that? Or are you always trying to maybe do the next thing?
Well, my goal is basically make music that I've been inspired off of.
Okay.
But I want it to be different. I want to give something people have never, like, heard before.
Okay.
You know, like, my idol is, like, Cisco.
Okay.
So he's very, like, innovative. You know what I mean? If you ever, like, listen to him, you'll see how his stuff was, like, different from everyone else's. So one thing I could advise to you artists out there, if you're making a song and it doesn't sound like, you know, exactly like that song, that's good. If it still sounds good but doesn't sound like the song you were going for, that's good. You know, because you want to sound like yourself. You don't want to copy someone else. You don't want to be like their carbon copy. So that's the best advice I could give.
Yeah. Sometimes bands will reinvent themselves or whatever. They'll come out and they'll do something, but then people always like what they kind of started with.
Yeah.
You know, they like their old stuff. And I'm thinking of Def Leppard right now.
Yes.
Def Leppard, you know, they kind of went to something different, which did sound good and everything. And people did we took it, but you know, they're more heavy metal and stuff like that. But sometimes, you know, you get caught in certain genres and stuff like that. And I know right now is like rap and stuff like that. That's coming out there. But you had the grunge. You know, you went through that stage where people were all trying to get that same sound. And, you know, it seems like the guys that do their own thing, seems like they could stay in it longer because people like that. You know, they get it's not something different. It's something different, so they're not hearing the same thing. Everything doesn't sound like the same music and same things.
Another thing too I noticed is that people will, like, throw that band to the wind if they switch their sound up.
Yeah.
So it's like, you didn't like that band. You just liked the style they were doing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like Metallica. Like, they came out with thrash,
yeah,
and then they became a little bit more heavy metal, and people like, oh, no, this is garbage.
Yeah.
You know?
So it's it is, but it's true. Like, when they try something, if they don't love it, either, you know, diehard people will always follow their band, I guess, and they'll give them a shot to try something different. But like you say, it's always that thing, you know? Mm-hmm. And I look at Prince. Prince was always different. I always loved Prince because
another influence of mine.
You know, he took his dad's music and he took songs and he, mm-hmm. you know, and I think he created a lot of songs that were different at the time. And I think in the 80s, you know, we had a lot of different kind of genres in the 80s. You know, we had Journey and you had the corporate bands, and then we had the rap because we had LL Cool J. So we had that, and then we had you know, I think the other artists, and I think, you know, he stood out because he did something different. And you heard that, you know, when you saw the album, I can't think of what deck it was with. It was the album back then in the day in the 80s when he was, Purple I know it's Purple Rain. That's Purple what I'm thinking. Rain. Yeah, that's yeah. It. Yeah. So
one of his best.
Yeah. No, that was a great album. And I think you look at every track that was on it and you can listen to it and you say, wow, you know, but it was all different. And you watch Purple Rain, the movie, and you're saying, wow, you know how talented he really was. And you see that, you know, this band put some
input into it.
Like, I feel like artists like Michael or Prince, or even Cisco for that matter, like, you can't really put them in a genre.
Right.
Same with me. You can't really put me in a genre because I'm so diverse. If you listen to the album, you'll see how I got, like, some up-tempo stuff. I got, like, some slow ballads, you know. But I tried to keep it, like, up-tempo.
Right.
But I try to, like, put, like, the soul into it as well.
Yeah, so when you're performing, do you go with the lower tempo stuff and then bring it up, or do you go by what the crowd is kind of giving you?
I've learned you got to feed off the crowd.
Yeah.
It's better to do it that way, but you also want to give them some diversity, too.
Yeah.
You know? So what I would do for the next time I perform is I would do, like, something like Don't Say I Didn't, and then after that it would be, like, G-Spot, and then something like You Got the Best Love.
Right.
You know, give them, like, something fast and then go for the ballad. Or go for the ballad first and go for, like, the big finish, like, last. Okay. That way you, like, save up, like, your energy.
Now, what happens if you had a Mariah Carey moment?
Oh, Lord.
Coming off 2017. You know, where something just happens and she just...
I mean, she's still a legend, though. She, like, even though, like, she had that moment, at least she played it off well. You know what I mean? At least she played it off well. Like, at least she didn't, like, pretend nothing happened.
Right.
Like, she actually was addressing, saying, oh, yeah, we didn't set up for this, da-da-da. But, like, through the whole set. So I could respect that. And they still loved it, though.
Yeah. No, the fans always going to love her. Like, she was out there. They said she had a diva moment. She didn't go out there and do the rehearsal beforehand. So there was a lot of things that were going on that she probably could have done. But, you know, she was saying it was the earpiece she couldn't hear from it. So, I don't know if we'll ever know because I don't think either side, you know, probably for somebody's going to sue somebody out of it, you know. So you'll probably never know what really happened. But, she was out there doing her thing and... Something just went awry, but she did. She still lived up to the fans. She did a few things, but the weird thing was the background dancers were all, they were all in sync. So their mics were working, their earpieces were working, so they were all going crazy. But
it's just like Mariah, her thing wasn't working, I guess.
Yeah, no, it wasn't going. So
goes to show you, you know, it's one thing about perfection. If you're off just a little tiny bit.
Yeah.
You know,
it changes things.
It changes everything.
It does.
Throws a monkey wrench, as they call it.
Yeah.
But people still, like, fight through it, you know.
That's what you have to do sometimes. I know this. You know? Yeah.
The show must go on.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So North Carolina, when will the move be?
Hopefully by February.
Okay.
Because
right around the corner.
I know. Because I've been, like, saving up.
Okay.
I've been going for extra hours.
Yep.
Income tax is coming.
And
so
all that,
I got my eyes on some apartments. So pretty much, you know, just like save up, hope for the best.
Right. Mm. Well, that's pretty good. So then you'll start the tour down there, right?
Yes.
Start it down there and then, you know, work your way maybe during the holidays or whatever back up here, right?
Oh, so, yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
it'll be pretty good. I'll have my dance team by then. So
yeah.
We can give y'all a show.
Yeah, it'd be great. Yeah. That'd be be one thing, come back and have kind of like we had LaMix in here.
Right,
these guys are great.
Imagine that.
Oh, yeah, we did a couple. We've done a couple musical shows, so we've had our music things. We've had our
also,
politics, our sports, all that.
Another thing too is I want to like get like a band together too.
Okay.
So that way, I feel like you give more of an experience with like a band.
Right.
You know?
It's more you can add more to the. I mean, when we had LaMix in here. It was they were a band and a half, I think. Yeah.
They had a lot of lead singers. They had
the horns, the keyboardists, the drummers. It was crazy when you saw all they did. It almost reminded me of Chicago.
Right.
Yeah, back in that type of, and it was one of those things. But we had a lot of people that watched, and they actually liked that, too. So, not as many hits as you got. You got pretty much, right up there with the most hits.
Heard... Like, it's crazy, though. Like, when my dad told me we got, like, the highest rating or something like that when I was up here.
We got the highest rating. We got the most hits afterwards. We got, it was pretty crazy. So, it was.
Casper hit the big time there, man.
He did it up, yeah. So, he got us some good ratings. So. So, it's good to have this guy on. So.
Absolutely. Yeah, moving to North start off the year.
Yeah.
Start off the year of the heavy hitter, right?
We're almost like NASCAR. Because they do their Super Bowl first and then go into it as everybody
Daytona.
Else.
That's
so we're following NASCAR's lead on this one. We're starting off with the heavy hitters and hopefully, maybe we can have them at the end of the year and kind of put that bookend on it, right?
Oh,
so we'll do that. So, it's going to be a lot of fun. Hey, can we go to another clip, Bruce? We got Bruce put another clip on and you can be entertained again, right?
Yeah, one more
step. Definitely.
Fire, 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 fire
Oakdale, okay, yeah.
And that's back. That's not too bad. Now, do you write your own music? How does this go? Like, how does that work?
Well, basically, I do write, but also have co-writers too.
Okay.
Which is like my brother and people who have also been like featured on the song.
All right.
But that song right there, I could take 100% credit for.
Okay.
And like that bridge part, I actually wrote on the spot, like in the studio.
Right.
Because my brother was like, all right, what you got? And I didn't have anything at the time. So I literally had to come up with that like in like 50 seconds.
Now, do you always keep like a pad on you or something like that, just in case something you say, wow, you know what, that's good lyric or that's something like that? Because I heard there was a funny story with Lionel Richie when he wrote Lady, and he was with Kenny Rogers.
Yeah.
And he came in, and Kenny Rogers says, yeah, this is a young guy from the Commodores or whatever. They want to talk to you about a song. So Kenny goes, okay, bring him over. So he brought him over before the show, and he says, well, what's the song? And he goes, Lady. And mm-hmm. he goes, okay, well, let me hear it. And he goes, well, it's just Lady right now. And he goes, so but I'm going to write a verse of it. And then Kenny wrote a verse of it. And then so they had the two verses, and they're like, this is really good. And then it's funny because it's one of the shows out in Vegas or whatever, and then Lionel Richie's there, and he goes, well, we got the two verses. What can we do? And he said, Lionel Richie was actually in the bathroom when he wrote the last verse. So he said, you know, it's just one of those things. But Lionel Richie always said, he goes, I'll be at a party, and I'll be writing down on a napkin or whatever.
Yeah.
Just something because mm-hmm. I want to, you know, I know where to take it later on or whatever, but something exactly. inspired him at that moment.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
your inspiration could do that too. Like, you could be mm-hmm. anywhere and just say, you know what, that may be a good song, right?
As weird as it sounds, like, Every time I'm walking, like thoughts just come to mind.
Right.
Like mm-hmm. melodies come to mind, lyrics come to mind. It's yeah. so weird. Like, it's like endorphins, like, really, like, put, like, a toll on your brain.
Right.
To just trigger that, like, creativity.
That's right in you.
Yeah.
It's like something you have, like a God-given gift that, you know, that a lot mm-hmm. of people like, because I wouldn't be able to do that, you know,
no,
think about
no.
it, I'm like,
yeah.
you know, it's just like one of those things that, you know, there's certain things everybody mm-hmm. can do, and I look at that, and I say, wow, you know, and like I said, I could already put you with other stars that are out there. I say, wow, you know, he sounds good, he's got that right rhythm and everything. It's just, you know, now
yeah.
it's a matter of just getting to the right people.
Yeah.
And getting it
yeah.
out there and
yeah.
getting your
getting
songs out there and mm-hmm. you know, hitting it up and... You know, like you say, you never know. Look at Justin Bieber. He was all YouTube, right?
Yeah.
It was just YouTube, and all of a sudden he's huge.
Yeah.
And, you know, so you're getting this out there. But you got a lot of followers again, and mm-hmm. we can touch base again. How do they get in touch with you again? If you can look at that camera there and just
look
tell them, hey,
let them go.
right there, give them. We got your tagline on the bottom over there. Go,
hey.
That's.
Well, yeah, just I'm on YouTube in case, like, you don't really have – you know, like a music app or anything, because not everyone has one. It's okay. But just go on YouTube, put in Casp'a, apostrophe before the last day, Unchain the Panther. You could stream my whole entire album. Or if you got Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, anything of that nature, I'm right there. Just type in Unchain the Panther. You could listen to the whole album.
So that's pretty good. So they have there's multiple
awesome.
Places they can go to.
Yeah,
yeah.
like it's
a veritable plethora.
The Panther is everywhere.
yeah, well, that's a good thing. That's what you want to be. You want to be out there, yeah.
You
so that's pretty
easy.
Cool.
You want to make it real easy for him to find you.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Absolutely. So that's not bad at all.
Yeah, because I remember before I was like, okay, we got to go to this link right here and that link right there. And they're like, you know what, I give up.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, that would be me, yeah, because I'm brutal with that. So, it's easier to follow you on Twitter and catch a couple little glimpses of the song and be like, okay, I'll go back. But,
we'll get to see
it tonight.
Twitter's good to find him.
Twitter's great, yeah, I know. And I have to say that you're out there and you're saying, like, it's funny, you respond to a lot of your fans, too.
Oh, yeah.
I've noticed that fans that write to them and you'll actually give them feedback, and that's pretty mm-hmm. cool because I'll see that on Twitter, and if somebody says something or whatever, right away you're firing off to them saying, hey, or, you know, I know you're busy and everything, but within a certain amount of time, he's always getting back to you.
The way I see it without my supporters, about my Panthers, my Pantherettes, I honestly wouldn't be anywhere. So I think it'd be rude of me not to, like, respond to them.
That's nice. So you're giving back to them, you know, and taking their feedback and saying, hey, you know
what,
responding to them, you know, that means a lot to the people that are watching you, because a lot of people don't do that, you know. You're going to get you get blank air or whatever, you know. You may say something, but somebody's not going to write back. But I notice how when I see it on Twitter, at least, the people seem like they're really – they're cool about it. They're like, whoa, you know, this guy's talking to me. I probably saw this guy or I watched his video and all of a sudden, bam, he's talking to me. So that's pretty cool. So it means a lot to the fans when, you know, they kind of get to, interact with their, you know, I guess the person they're idolizing or whatever. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
Isn't
yeah,
that fun? Yeah. So, yeah, that's not bad at all. We're going to go to the Spinano Spin right now. We're gonna, John, you have something for us for the New Year's, right?
Yeah.
Right here. So we got something coming up.
Resolutionist.
And then we're going to come back to the Panther. He's going to, we'll finish up with him. So it'll be good.
Sure.
All right. Welcome back to another Spinano Spin as we are 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days into the year 2017. We hope it's off to a smashing start for you. And I guess I'm talking to the resolutionists. Is that what they're called? The ones who have made resolutions going forward for the 2017 year? I believe that's what it is. Let's talk a little bit about that. You made your New Year's resolution. You're as excited as all get out coming out of the gate. You're hitting the gyms. You're hitting whatever. You're hitting the library. You're doing whatever you can to make sure that everything is on track for your new year. Well, that's big. That's important. But you know one thing that has a lot to do with all that? I think you know. It's your influencers. It's the people you're hanging around with. When you were doing stuff last year, are they the same people you're hanging around with this year? Are those the ones that are starting to make your new year the way you want it to be? That's the question. Is it okay? Is everyone that you're talking to got you thinking the right way? Are the ones you're spending the most time with? You know, there's an old saying, and let's take a look at it right here. You are the average of the five people you spend most of your time with. That's who you are. It comes down to that. I don't know. You know, what's the old saying? Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right of me. I'm not sure if that's the truth, but it's up to you. This is your chance to make sure that your resolutions, which I'm sure you took great thought into and thought about for a I would say at least 20, 30, maybe 40 days of what you wanted to become. That's your chance. You have an opportunity, but you got to realize people will influence you. And what influences them? See, there's an old adage. They say how to kill a rumor, how to kill anything that's starting. Well, someone says so-and-so is pregnant. Where'd you hear it from? Well, I heard it from so-and-so. Well, where did they hear it from? I don't know. Well, don't you think you ought to find out? Don't you ought to find out who's influencing you? Who these influencers are? Take a look at the circle of people around you. I'm going to go to the gym every day. I'm going to work out every day. Well, so-and-so, Negative Nancy, says you can't do that. What about this? What about that? Oh, you're right, Nancy. I shouldn't do that. Oh, okay. Thanks, Nancy. Thanks for helping me out. That's not helping you out. You know, one other thing, too, the influencers. Well, if your best friends are the ones you met at the bar, they might not be a good person to teach you how to drink less, right? Or the best friend is the one you stand around smoking with outside. That might not be the best person to teach you how not to smoke. You get my drift? Or let's put it in a positive light, because this is all about being as positive as we can be. If your best friends are the ones you met at the gym, maybe you might want to think, maybe that is a good friend. Somebody dedicated or maybe committed a little bit to making themselves improve on one level or the other. Or maybe the best friend you met was the one you met at church. That might be a good one too. Person committed to or their faith and making sure that they understand more about how to be better to people. Those are the types of things you're looking for. You're looking for the right influencer. You're looking for the being around people that are positive. If a person doesn't take the time to tell you that they believe in you, they trust you, and believe you can do special things, that might not be the person you want to spend your time with talking about doing something great. That might not be somebody you want to talk to. You know, one thing, too, another thing that's happened in the country today really kind of gets on my nerves, and I think it's worth talking about just from a positive standpoint. You got a president who's never spent a day in office. never spent a day at any sort of public political office. And his first job is being president. Now, in this country, tell me if I'm wrong, don't we root for the underdog? Don't we root for the person that comes out of nowhere and becomes something absolutely great? Don't we all root for that? I think we do. And then in a great way, the press and the political pundits out there try to tear a person down as they're once they've made their climb. Well, the president at this point in time has overcome incredible odds. You can honestly say he came out of nowhere. Everyone said he won't be able to do it. He just goes ahead and does it. You got to be that kind of person. You got to inspire to that kind of person. You got to say, this is my year. 2017, start with the self-talk. I'm the greatest. I could do something incredible. Just watch. I'll do it. I'm going to make my commitments. I'm going to live up to my commitments. I'm going to be a person you're very proud of at the end of 2017. And you know what matters the most? How proud are you? How proud are you about what you've done? That's what it's all about. You got to focus on who's influencing you. You got to focus on what you decided was the most important things to do this year, and you got to go out and do it. I believe you can. The Spinato Spin team believes you can. We're all going to be watching you. Again, you can always get to me. You got my Twitter contact. Let me know how you're doing. I hope that you will have a fantastic 2017. And believe me, you met me over this intercom or whatever this sort of media is. I'm in your corner, and I really think you could do something special. And I hope you have a wonderful week. Thanks a lot for listening, and we'll catch you next time. Thank you.
It's a good way to start off the New Year's,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, bang, right?
Coming right up.
Exactly.
Yeah, he just went, threw the haymaker. He didn't even set up with a jab or anything. He just threw it and said, hey, I'm going to land that one right on the chin. That's it. So that hit hard. So that's good.
Well, yeah. We were talking about influence. You know, I hope I've made a good influence on my son here, Dan, you know,
yeah.
Mr. Casp'a.
Yeah. Well,
and,
I think you have.
You know, never stop dreaming, never stop believing. That's my attitude always.
Yeah, and he seems like he has it. You know, he doesn't seem like he wants to quit or nothing. No. I don't think you have any quitting.
Yeah,
right? No. Nah,
quitting's not going to happen.
Nah.
There you go.
But it seems like you have that passion. Like, this is a passion for you. So you're doing it, you know, not only for yourself, it's something that you do. But like I said, we've seen it a lot of times on your Twitter feed where you're actually kind of bringing people who can relate to your songs, which is really cool in that way, because I think that's important when people can relate to a song and say, you know, and like I said, I see that in your following already with people. Yeah. So that's got to inspire you too to say, hey, you know, I want to keep doing what I'm doing. Or I want to keep, you know, what's the next one going to be? Because you're so successful in this album right here. So it's like good to see that coming out. And it's like, wow, it's pretty cool. So
yeah,
definitely.
So hopefully 2017's got a lot of it's got a big path for you. So
yes.
You ready for it?
I'm definitely ready.
Seems like you're ready. Like I said, I've been following you for the last year, and I know you were real excited about getting this album out. And I know.
Oh yeah.
It was probably tough for you because a lot of fans were asking for it. I know you were putting some little snippets like we saw the first one out there, and everybody's like, mm-hmm. "Well, give me more." But it wasn't really out there yet. And then finally, till it actually came out, was it finally a relief in November when you were like, "It's out"?
It was. As soon as my brother sent me the finished copies.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as he sent me them, I was like, "Yes, I can finally put it out." But I had to save up for the TuneCore thing.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Because I could have just easily put it on SoundCloud, which I did, you know. But then it was like, let me take this off because I didn't want people pretty much just streaming it and getting it for free.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. Well, you have to get paid too because you want to get to that next level. You want to get your dancers all set up.
Yeah.
You got an apartment you got to get down there.
Yeah.
You got to do that. You know,
you
got to be hitting the bricks down there in North Carolina trying to do all you can to, you know.
Absolutely.
Get to that next level. So it'd be pretty cool.
Any money he's going to make from, he's going to pour back into the business.
Right.
And that's how you get your name out there stronger and better. That's your focus, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want to increase the brand. You don't want to just let it stay small.
Right.
Right.
And that's one way to feed it.
That's exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And I think he's doing a great job with that right now. I think he's found a good formula. So hopefully he can just continue it and keep building, you know, that audience that's out there that could be out there. And, like I said, it's pretty cool. And, you know, what comes next, we'll have to see, right?
Well, I already have in mind what I want my album to be. for the next time.
Okay.
Is basically going to be a very more balladful, but still like up-tempo.
Okay.
Kind of like this one, except like a more mature sound.
All right.
Because it actually has like a concept, you know. Mm. And a lot of the songs are dedicated to my queen.
Yep.
You know, mm-hmm. So it pretty much starts off where I'm like not going through a good time. Right. You know what I mean? And then I just have like the, you know, I'm going to just do whatever phase. And then I meet her, and I start developing feelings, and then all of a sudden it just goes like from really light. So it goes from really dark to really light.
Light. Oh, that's good. Awesome. Yeah. No, that's one thing I did appreciate about your music and everything. I think you see all these rappers and everything, and they're kind of tearing apart women right now and stuff like that, and they're treated mm-hmm. like an object.
Yeah.
And not really. And I that's what I really loved about your music, because when I've watched you know, some of the videos or heard some of them, it just comes back that, you know, you're almost bringing back somebody's daughter or whatever you want to treat like a queen.
Exactly.
And you just said, it's my queen. So
yeah,
that's
queen.
What's really, you know, because I have a daughter, so you know, I'd like somebody to treat her like a queen someday instead of getting this, you know, this rap mentality where, you know, it's just treated as an object. So
exactly.
I think you look at that, and that's what I really appreciate about your album. I think that's where you're really going to, you know, I think that's where you got me at least, and I think a lot of people are going to enjoy that when they start listening to it and see how you know, they idolize women in those things.
Yeah.
I think that's a good thing. That's like a role model way of doing it.
Because, like, I feel right now, like, the love in the music right now is pretty much gone.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I'm trying to, like, bring it back. There are other artists that are doing that.
Right.
But there's not too many.
I think it's slowly, like, some do, and it's like they are trying to bring it back. And I look at the 80s, and I say to my kids all the time, like, you know, I know they listen to Eminem, and he's got great beats. Don't get me wrong. I said, I go, how the heck do you listen to this when we're working out downstairs or whatever? And he's like, what are you talking about? This is great. And I said, yeah, it is, but you're talking about smoking pot, and then we're lifting to it. And I was like, it kind of is like, you know, it's almost like an oxymoron or whatever. I was like, I understand it, but I said, you know, I put on an old Rocky tape or whatever, you know, I can work out forever at that, you know, just because it inspired you. And I look at, like, Journey had the power ballads and all those things,
and you had
all these great love songs in the 80s and like the late 70s into the early 80s and things like that. Mm. And I always thought, I said, look at our generations, we were actually kind of focused more on that. And now you got the rap that, you know, kind of going the opposite way with it. And it's more of like I said, the
more dark.
It's darker and treating women like objects. Whereas your music comes in and starts bringing it back, it's kind of meeting in the middle again. And that's where you want it. Because, you know, there's nothing wrong with what they're saying or whatever, but it's just a different theme to it. But
exactly.
I just think you're getting overloaded with it. Yeah, but
you
need that. You need that difference in it, so it's cool. So
Because, I mean, I can name, like, a few artists that I actually like that, you know, shed positivity towards women, like Absol, Lil Uzi. Not a lot of people like Lil Uzi.
Yeah.
But I like him. I like you, homie. But, yeah, I mean, it just, I feel we need to have more positivity.
Absolutely, I think so too.
Yeah.
Especially in this world right now, because I think we're really getting divided in all different directions. And, you know, it would be nice to kind of gather. You know, I look at some of the old songs and things that people had sung together, or people, groups come together to do, you know, certain things. And do you, if you had an artist right now, if you could say, I want to work with this guy, who would it be?
Right now,
that's a good question.
Oh, man. Well, that is a very good question. Like, I feel like you kind of want to do a song with your idol, but then again, you don't.
Yeah.
Because you want to be on that level, but you know that it'll be, like, two of you, like, on the same track.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And that's what I don't want. But I don't know, man. Like, I pretty much just collab with my brothers. You know what I mean? Like, I collab with my brothers and, like, people I know. But if I had to, like, choose, like, right now, I would probably go with, probably Lil Uzi.
Lil Uzi.
Yeah.
Go on tour with him.
Yeah,
and then come out for a couple songs at the end of it or whatever. Because
we both, like, got, like, kind of, like, a similar style with the anime rock star thing.
Okay.
You know? Because, like, on the cover of my album, I'm holding a fireball.
Yep.
You know, and that's what they do, like, in, like, the anime shows I like. Like, they, you know, like, tie towards, like, their enemies and stuff like that. And conjure up energy with, like, an energy ball or something. So, Yeah.
Like Dragon Ball Z.
Exactly. Yeah. I was thinking of that too. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was Street sure Fighter. You knew it. Yeah.
The Hadouken.
Hadouken.
Yeah. Sitting there, Ken and Ryu.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Throwing those out there. But yeah, no, I was just thinking, as soon as you said it, I was thinking about that. Yeah.
It's good, because that's the millennials, right? The millennials like that.
They do.
Yeah, they're all over that.
Well, that's what you want to do, and you want to reach your target audience, and then you hope you bring in some more people, as it goes on. And, you see all these different artists, I always think of Tony Bennett working with Lady Gaga.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm bringing it in, and they're different kind of talents, but they actually can, talent together is really good.
You just got done with the holiday season with Bing Crosby when he sung with David Bowie.
Oh, yeah.
That was incredible.
It really was.
I mean, that was an incredible mix.
I'm laughing, though, because I remember I saw the original, and then I saw the one with Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly.
Yeah.
Definitely got to check that out.
No, that is a good one. Yeah, that is definitely funny.
Parody of it. Yeah. No, it's good stuff, though. And anything that bridges the gap.
No, it really
anything is. That brings two interests together is always great.
It's not a bad thing at all.
And I love the way he does that, too.
Yeah.
You made a good point.
No, absolutely. I think that's good. I like that about it, and I think that's, like I said, that drew me into his music, and I said, this is something I can listen to and something I can actually like, not just because of the rhythm, but if you actually listen to the words, there's meaning behind it. And I think that's important, because I think a lot of times we get caught up in hearing a rhythm or something, and it's good to work out to, but it's not really, like I said, Eminem, but if you listen to words, it's kind of counteracting what I'm trying to do. But... Like I said, there's that angry thing. I know Twisted Sister said, when they started their album, it was, we're not going to take it. And he recognized all these angry kids coming out. And he said, then he became a millionaire. And they said, well, why didn't you make it? And he goes, because I wasn't angry anymore. He goes, I woke up, I was jumping in the pool, I was driving a nice car. He goes, I lost it. He goes, I lost, but, so it wasn't really what he was doing anymore. But it was funny.
Yeah.
But you look at certain artists like that. And we've lost a lot. Like you said, David Bowie this year. And we lost Prince, and we also lost George Michael before. So,
And the thing is, just got into George Michael.
Did you really?
A few weeks ago.
Oh.
Yeah.
And then he passed.
See, I'm a big George Michael fan way back in the 80s, and, because that was our decade that I grew up in, and I loved him. I loved him coming out of the gates and all the songs that he did. I didn't so much like Wham. I did appreciate some of the songs. Oh. I like Last Christmas, and I like, there's some other albums, but when George Michael came out with his solo album, I loved it. Monkey, I think it's a different...
Yes. First time I ever heard that, I'm like... And then, I listened to it, I'm like, oh, okay, he's talking about a heroin fiend.
Yeah.
Okay, makes
but it's a great
sense.
Song and everything. Yeah, yeah. It's like, but another guy that can, he really wrote to somebody's, whether it's a problem or whether it's a love or something like that, you have to really respect their talent and where they're going with that. So that, like you said, you see, when he's writing, like you say, there's passion, you could just look at something and say, oh my God, I'm going to write about that. This is what I'm going to do next or whatever. And you already got your next album all pretty much set up to where you want to go. Maybe it's not all written, all done out with the music yet, but.
I actually do have a few songs written. I just need to go to my brother and have him make instrumentals around it.
Okay. All right.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Because that's how we did this one. No lie. When we got in the studio, what happened was it was never, okay, make this beat and I'll make a song to it.
Right.
I already had a song written, and he made a beat around it.
Right.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's what they said. Was it Smokey Robinson and Miracles did with Stevie Wonder's song?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's basically how they got that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tears of a Clown. It was one of those type of songs that had a circus type of sound that they added on to it, because that was basically what the song was about.
Oh, wow.
You're right, though. So you would come in. He already has a way in which he can wrap the beat around the song, and sometimes they wrap the song around the beat.
Well,
that's all, that's all possible.
Pretty much every beat he made was after I sang something.
So
that's pretty good.
For instance, the song, did you ever hear a song? I think it's by, who is it? Not Bobby Vinton. Frankie Valli wrote a song, Oh What a Night.
Yeah.
Well, that was an original song about the end of Prohibition.
Oh, wow.
And he made that sound, that became Oh What a Night.
Oh, wow. It's funny so how you find out.
The beat was there. He wrapped the song around it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And that, but then you're saying, I got the idea, and I'll put some music around it.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So you could sometimes, yeah, I guess yeah. That's the great thing about music, because you can do it the opposite way. Exactly. You know, it's not like, but yeah, sitting there.
Because I'm going to be honest, when I first started, I didn't know about keys. I didn't know about any of that.
Yeah.
But as I started working with my brother more, I learned all about that. I learned how to, like, what this key is, what that key is, and pretty much not going off.
Right.
You know?
That's awesome.
So.
Yeah.
Now, dance moves.
Dance moves.
How do you get those? Because I watch these guys, you know, well, everybody, I remember when Michael Jackson, you know, did the moonwalk for the first time, and everybody was going crazy, and, you know, you saw kids the next day in the hall doing the moonwalk, mm-hmm. and I was like, how the hell are they doing that?
Well, when I get my group together, I want to be able to do all the choreography.
Okay.
But as a solo artist, I want a choreographer.
All right.
You know, because I want it to be where you mix up, like, the kung fu moves with the dance moves.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't really know any by heart. So, of course, I need to reach out to others to do it.
Right.
So, because I reached out to this one dude. He taught me a few things, you know.
And then.
But after that, our schedules got, like, constricted and. But if you're watching this, Jason, I would definitely like to work with you again, man.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Shoot him this video.
Yeah. That'd be pretty cool. Yeah. Because you can always learn from somebody else, and that's what's great about it. You know, you always take it in. It seems like you're. You know, your brother and you have a great rapport with everything. You know, you just come together, and like you said, you can write a song, he can write the music. It's no problem. Like, you almost see where you both are coming. You know,
exactly.
you may be coming from a different direction, but you end up at the same place, and that's what's cool about it. So,
like, one thing I always ask fans for is, like, do you like my voice on this track?
Right.
You know, because it's like, the beat's hot, you know what I mean? But I want how I sound on it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they'd be like, oh, yeah, I like your voice, I like your voice. I was like, okay, cool. You know, because I've only been singing for, like, 2 years.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just learning. Like, I'm slowly learning. Like, I just learned, like, 2 weeks ago how to sing in my head voice.
Okay.
Before, I did not know how to do that at all. But honestly, like, it's good for, like, little ad-libs and background vocals.
Right.
But I would never go straight, like, Prince or Smokey Robinson with it.
Right.
You know? Even though, like, I love what they do. I love those artists. But I would never want to go straight falsetto in the song.
Right. Well, it's funny, when Prince had passed away, you actually found out how far his song stretched out, because I know he wrote for the Bangles, and he wrote for, there's like five, you know, other bands that were really, that he had top tens.
Yeah.
And you think, why didn't he sing these? And I know, you know, Manic Monday is probably better for a female group to sing, but you look at it and you say, you know, he wrote it, it was a great song, and it worked for them, but it's like, wow, you know, you see how, you know, he probably wrote it and said, you know, this is, like you say, you sing it, and he was like, this isn't me, but I'll keep it here, and then when somebody comes along, I think they could do it, I'll give it to them, and it you know, it works
like,
out.
I mean, I'd love to write for females, you know, because I feel like pretty much what people don't understand is you're basically just saying an emotion, you know what I mean? You're saying how you feel, but you're not exactly saying, like, a gender.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Or what I do, or what I did before when I wrote for females, I basically just wrote down what women have been saying to me.
Yeah.
You know? And putting it in song.
In a song.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Yeah. See, that's smart.
Yeah, that's smart.
Because there's a duet on the album called Believe in My Love.
Okay.
Featuring my brother's girlfriend, Envy.
Yep.
And basically what I did was I just pictured everything a female has told me in a relationship that I've, like, argued with.
And
put it in lyrics.
That's pretty good.
But me and my queen good, though. We never argue.
That's important.
Yeah.
So, well, you look at it from their perspective, too. So
exactly.
It's a little different. It's not like you're just going in with this tunnel vision and saying, this is what it is, and that's it.
Yeah.
So it's like, but like I said, I see a lot of that in your music, and that's what's really good about it. I think that a lot of people are going to enjoy it when it comes, you know, when you become famous. It's going to be pretty cool.
So
we can say, hey.
Yeah.
Who's here at the take, you know? Right here in Little Wallingford, Connecticut. So, it's not bad. We're going to look forward to seeing where you're going to go in the next couple
Couple months.
Yeah, it's going to be wild. So, go down there in North Carolina. I know that they've you know, like I was telling your dad, we met Chris Lane, actually does a promo for the show or whatever. He's a big country guy now, but it was the same thing. He was just kind of doing his own thing. He wrote one really good song, The Fix, right now.
Yeah.
He's following up with other stuff going out on this album, but, you know, he's doing a lot of things in country music, so it's pretty cool. Wow. And he was he went over here in Oakdale. In the Oakdale over there, I got a chance to meet him, and, you know, he got to talk to him and plug the show here, and it was pretty cool. So
that was an awesome intro. Yeah. Awesome ID, as we call it.
Yeah.
ID'd the show. And he's, I've seen him on commercials now. And
yeah, he's all over 92.5. You always hear a song on that. So it's, you never know, you know. And I know he's a North Carolina boy, so he's always at the Panthers, everything. He's a big Panthers fan down there. Yeah, so you got to tell him you're a Panther. Yeah. You get him, so,
yeah. That's right. Carolina Panthers.
That's what it is,
Yeah, this guy might become the lead
He could be the spokesperson down there for Carolina Panthers.
I could, like, perform before, like, the football game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you wouldn't kneel, would you?
Oh, man.
No, that's tough. Yeah, no, that's why we're out there. I know that Kaepernick, we talked about it a bunch of time, but
yeah.
I think it's supporting, you know, America and everything. But
like, I have my own opinion on that, you know what I mean? Like, one thing I've been able to do with all these things that have been going on in the world,
yep,
for certain, like, stands and stuff like that,
okay,
I've been looking at things from, like, both sides of the spectrum.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Like, okay, like him not kneeling. Like, I could look at it, I could see why people would be upset, you know, but I could see, like, his reason for it, too. You know, so it's like I can't really get mad.
You're in between on it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I'm in between about a lot of things when it comes to, like, taking stands.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, I know the performers right now, and I know they're talking about the inauguration coming up and everything, and they're saying that Ricky Martin actually went to – he did it for George W. Bush, but now they're saying that you're almost going to get a black eye if you go out and perform for Trump.
Yeah.
So it's like one of those things. But then, you know, they're saying if you go do it, you know, they were wrong. Everybody else was wrong about things because they were wrong about, you know, like I said, he was going to be the Republican nominee, and then he wasn't going to be Hillary and all these things. And he's kind of done things that nobody's ever done before. So, you know, they're looking at it as if you do go, maybe you'll get a bunch of new supporters or whatever. But if Donald called you today and said, would you sing at the thing? No. You're not a big Donald fan?
No, I'm not. Yeah. I don't like either of them, honestly. Yeah. Like, I don't know. It's just like the only... Nah,
we'll get off that anyway. We only got like a minute 20 something.
Yeah, we don't want to jeopardize any following you have.
Yeah, we don't. Yeah, yeah, that's exactly. Yeah.
Because
people are so, it's either black or white. You know, it's like one of those things now. There's no gray anymore.
There's no gray.
No, there really isn't. Yeah, so it's either they love you or they hate you. It's whatever side you're taking. So I know that's one of those things. And that's a tough thing. And as a performer, you really don't want that. And I think that's where it's kind of getting at. It's like, you know, I think so many people don't want to be alienated by it because they did this for him.
Right.
And then, you know, people are saying, well, if you did it, you'd probably get more following. But it's one of those things. I don't think you'd know until we actually see somebody go out there and do it. So it's, you know.
Right.
And I know there's people that are friends of him that said, you know, I can't because I think that I'll lose fans. So it's crazy. It's one of those things.
Yeah.
But,
when Kanye said he would have voted for Trump and everybody just went all up in arms. You know, I could understand why, like, certain people would. I think it's more, like, for the money thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's one thing with, like, a Trump supporter. If you're supporting Trump, I want to know why.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I want to know why you did this. Or if you're a Hillary supporter, I want to know why.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I feel people should, like, ask people's reasons for their politics.
Yeah, that's why we had that debate on the show.
Yeah, we had a good debate.
Yeah, right before the election.
Anyway, we're running out of time right now, so we got to cancel the show. We want to thank you very much for coming on. Thanks for entertaining us tonight. We wish you the best of luck.
Thank
you. You know, hopefully at the end of the year we'll get him back, and he's you know, he's going for one of the big-time songs or whatever. So we'll see you on somewhere out there on the radio stations all the time being played on. So it'd be cool. It'd be real cool to have you on, and then, you know, look back and say, wow, look what we had later on, you know?
Yeah.
That'd be cool. Anyway, we want to wish everybody a happy new year. Thank Casp'a again. Like I said, he's a told you a bunch of times how to get in touch with him, how to watch his stuff.
Yes,
you got right. John on the radio station on Saturday night.
Yep,
what we got?
WNHU.org, 6 to 8 this Saturday.
And we'll see you all next week. Thanks again for watching the take. Say a prayer for someone out there because they probably need it. So
absolutely.
Have a great night.
Have a good one.